Hi, I'm Edwin Samuelson, and welcome to the CineFiles. Mike, I'm going to tell you what, I know you're a huge science fiction guy, and you know a lot about Philip K. Dick, so why don't you give us a little overview of the guy.
I am a huge Philip K. Dick fan. I adore his stuff. What is wonderful about Philip K. Dick's work is it is very gray. He is big on the dystopia. He shows that human beings are not going to live in this like Star Trek world where everything is great and nice. And he loves delving into alternative history. He loves delving into other dimensions. His books and also his movies are big into what you see is not always what you get.
It's like he was probably schizophrenic. He believed that he had suddenly saw the light and that we were actually all descended from, you know, some other, whether it's aliens or something like that. And
his writings just on his personal philosophies are very, very way out in left field.
Not your traditional sci-fi kind of writer.
I've read a little bit about
philosophy guy.
He sounds like he's a really fascinating guy, and it's obvious he was a radical, you know, like a I could say like a 60s type, Jerry Rubin type. I'm not saying he was a political, like, you know, out there, but he believed in a certain concept.
But he wasn't very popular while he was. I mean, he didn't actually reach his success until weirdly posthumously. I mean, like, up until
No. Yeah, he reached success maybe in the last 2 years of his life.
Yeah.
Because he was actually on the set of Blade Runner. He wasn't really
that
happy.
He died just after Blade Runner.
He wasn't happy with the making of Blade Runner for whatever reason. But, no, he was poor most of his life. He ate dog food because he couldn't afford real food. He could afford amphetamines, though, and that's what helped him write so much, as he got so high on amphetamines.
That's the most fascinating thing to me about Philip K. Dick, because you had an excellent overview there, is where everyone thinks the future automatically is better. You know, technology is great. This is going to be great. But the thing is that you see that 1984 aspect in his work, where the you know, someone is watching, someone is trying to take advantage of you, not everyone is who they seem to be.
He almost runs a parallel by saying the more technology man has available, the more a man de-evolves.
Well, let's get into his filmmaking, because, I mean, that's important here. Let's talk about the first film. And actually, I mean, if this is going to be the first work adapted from your stuff, you're damn lucky. And that is Blade Runner.
Set the tempo.
Which was filmed by Ridley Scott. It was his follow-up to Alien.
Yeah, it's based on Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, which is a novella.
And it was
long,
expanded.
Short story, short novel.
It was expanded by David Peoples, who actually went on to write Unforgiven, into a feature-length screenplay, and it starred Harrison Ford, hot off the Star Wars and Raiders of the Lost Ark film.
Deckard.
What they call a Blade Runner, which is a person who is actually kind of like a detective who hunts after replicants, which were artificially created human beings that were, I guess you say, were kept as slave labor. They were
almost like glorified toys.
They were toys. They were kept as you know, they were like sex, you know, replicants, everything. They were just kept.
There were work replicants. There were sex replicants.
Basically, they were slaves.
They were slaves, and they escape a prison. And unfortunately, the one thing about replicants is they look just like human beings. And Harrison Ford gives, as Deckard, gives a test to see if these people are replicants or not. And because the replicants all share the same childhood memories, dreams, which is fascinating when you're. Some of the replicants don't even know that they are replicants themselves. And I thought that was a very interesting concept. Rucker Hauer is one of the replicants, as is Daryl Hannah. And Brian James, poor guy who passed away a few years ago, terrific actor, actually is a very memorable interrogation
scene. Joanna Crosby?
Cassidy.
Joanna Cassidy,
who is actually has a great scene as a stripper.
Beautiful.
In a beautiful outfit. The film was shot, actually, a lot of it was shot in Tokyo, because Tokyo was a very modern city at the time.
What about the actor that played the scientist?
Joe Turkel, who was actually in The Shining.
Shining as the bartender.
As the bartender, very good actor again. The one thing that I really love about Blade Runner is that it's not just a science fiction film, it's also based on film noir. Very beautifully filmed movie. I mean, gorgeous to look at. I mean, some people complain about the actual lack of, you know, of story, but I don't think that's a problem.
People who do that, they're not very smart.
A lot of people don't actually. Blade Runner is not just one of the best science fiction movies ever made. It's probably one of the best movies ever made. I mean, it was one of the first compelling visions of the future on film. Up to that point, you had Star Wars vision of sci-fi, or you had like the Logan's Run version of sci-fi. Everything's sort of clean, all that stuff. This is like the first science fiction movie that I've seen that came out where you like say, okay, that's a future that looks real. It was the attention to detail, like you know, Ridley Scott's background in commercial filmmaking. making commercials, you could tell highly influenced a lot that's going on, that we're in a culture just totally consumed by media, advertising, all sorts of stuff. It just runs rampant in this film. Even the particular attention to detail on fashion, how different characters are dressed different ways.
People have criticized Harrison Ford's performance for many years. They're saying it's emotionless and everything.
I want to know who these people are.
Well, yeah, I have heard that, because the problem is that the one thing, he's losing his humanity as, you know, hunting for these people. And just recently, actually, Ridley Scott confirmed it, that Deckard, in fact, is a replicant.
Yeah, but you know what, though? Honestly, for one thing, I've seen the director's cut and the original one. The narration, everyone knows that narration was forced on there.
Well, let's get to what story.
I didn't mind the narration.
The studio, actually, let's just get into that so we can talk about this, because there's so many different cuts of Blade Runner. In fact, if you go onto the IMDb, you can see there's must be 5 or 6 versions. People don't realize this. There's a 70mm version which has different dialogue and footage in it. But anyway, let's get to the main version. The main version was turned in by Ridley Scott. The studio hated it. They said, this is crap. They recut the film. They put in narration to fill in blocks. And actually, I like the narration, as you guys say, because it felt like an old detective film, and it actually went in well with the stuff.
Exactly.
Then in 1992, on a break from Thelma and Louise, Ridley Scott went back and inserted some footage, dropped the narration, and he actually said that's not really his director's cut because he didn't have enough time to really finish it, but it was as close to a director's cut as it was at that time. Right now, they're actually going back and they're preparing a new cut, which he says is going to incorporate all the footage he wanted in there and everything. And
actually, for the DVD,
which is coming out soon. One thing very interesting, they changed the ending in the theatrical version to, and they've used outtake footage from The Shining. How would you say this compares to the original novella? Is it very close?
I didn't read it. I'll be...
No, it's not close.
No?
There's an entirely different concept going on in the original novella, like the Deckard character's married, you know, all sorts of stuff. It's a good story. It's just, they kind of took the idea, the seed of the story, and kind of did their own thing with it for the movie.
It took a long time for Philip K. Dick to come back to the screen. In fact, but as early as 1986, there was a film in development, but it took a long time for it to come to the screen. In fact, it was attached to many different directors, and it actually went through 70 different drafts. One of the directors attached was, at one time, David Cronenberg, and the film is Total Recall. It was supposed to be made by Dino De Laurentiis, but he went bankrupt. Arnold Schwarzenegger actually at the time saw the script and begged Dino De Laurentiis to make it with him, but he said no. And then Patrick Swayze was attached, other many people.
Richard Dreyfuss.
Richard Dreyfuss was Cronenberg's choice.
Yeah.
And once it switched over and it was floating around, then Swayze became the second choice.
Mm-hmm.
And then once Verhoeven got a hold of the rights to direct it, that's when he chose Schwarzenegger.
Actually, Schwarzenegger saw the script. He loved it. He begged this studio, Caroco, who he did films for, you know, independent production company, to buy the script. And they bought it because Dino De Laurentiis went bankrupt. It took a lot of red tape. But the film came to the screen in 1990 and actually became one of the best films in Arnold Schwarzenegger's filmography. Actually, I think it's the second best film after his Terminator series. I would go on and say this is one of the best science fiction films in history. I really will, because I love the concept. Arnold Schwarzenegger plays a character named Quaid, who is a construction worker who is married to his wife, at the time unknown, Sharon Stone. And he wants to take a vacation with a place called Recall, which implants artificial memories where people who don't actually want to go to Mars, you know, because of the dangers of going, actually have memories implanted that are real as they can be. His wife and his friends are against the idea, but he decides to go anyway, and he goes there, and they hit what they call a memory cap, and they find out he was actually already on Mars, and he decides to go to Mars because
It's like a science fiction version of The Manchurian Candidate. It's the idea that you have buried memories in your head and you don't even know it, and then something happens and this comes through and you become another person.
Yeah, and the thing that's interesting is that he finds out that this character he was living, it was a complete lie, that his whole life, which I think is probably the most fascinating aspect of the film, is that he never existed.
Or you could say a science fiction version of the Bourne series.
Sort of like a science fiction version of Bourne series. I think...
I can't do it justice.
I think Total Recall is a really entertaining film.
Very entertaining.
Great action.
Ending kind of falls apart a little bit.
I don't think it's one of the greatest sci-fi films out there. I think that it would have been very intriguing to see what would have happened if Cronenberg directed it.
Oh, yes.
And it starred Richard Dreyfuss, because then you'd have an entirely different thing going on. Because the whole premise of the film is like you have a guy who's supposed to be an ordinary working schlub Joe who finds out he was this super spy.
Almost like a Walter Mitty type
right.
take
and
on it.
And if it was truly, truly pure Philip K. Dick, they would keep playing with the meta idea of, okay, is this real, is this not, is this real, is this not, and never gets to that point. It's just, it's an action film.
Actually, I disagree with you on that. There's a great scene where Arnold Schwarzenegger is in a hotel room, and a character who actually is the owner of a recall comes up to him and says, if you want to believe this, you're actually in the chair, take this pill now. This is all a dream.
Right.
This is not reality. If you want to wake up, take
this
pill.
But that's it. I mean, the ending of the film, I don't think the film is that deep. I really don't.
Well, for it's an Arnold Schwarzenegger film, it's pretty damn deep. And I love I love Paul Verhoeven. I think the guy is one of the greatest directors. I think he's a genius. And the thing that I love about him is he goes so overboard in everything he does, but yet he doesn't go so over the top that it's ridiculous. He just makes it like there's these violent scenes.
Oh, I think it's a great action film, and I think it's I do think it's one of Schwarzenegger's best movies. It's just that you're talking about is it a good Philip K. Dick adaptation? Well, maybe I would have liked to seen a lot more playing with the idea of reality.
Well, I'll tell you,
even leaving this question, this open-ended ending. Well, did he really save the day? Is he really that person? Is he still stuck in that thing?
Schwarzenegger is not a typical Philip K. Dick hero, though.
Well, that's the thing.
A typical Philip K. Dick hero is a middle-aged guy that is feeling his aches and pains, kind of schlubby.
I'd say an accountant.
More the
accountant type.
More the books.
It's like a Hitchcockian idea,
heroes.
like the nightmare behind normalcy. It's like you have this guy who looks. That's why I always was intrigued by the idea of Richard Dreyfuss, because it's like this guy that you would think is not outstanding, nothing exceptional. Fine, turns out he's a super spy.
Well, the one thing you have a very good point here, and this actually goes back to proving about casting. It's like I'll give you a perfect example. I was reading earlier that. Death Wish, the original Death Wish, written by Brian Garfield, the character was originally an accountant, and they wanted to play Jack Lemmon to play the character. But when you get Charles Bronson there, he can't play an accountant, so they made him an architect. It's the same thing with Schwarzenegger. He could not play like an average middle-aged guy because he just does not fit that type.
So they made him a construction worker.
They made him a construction worker, which is more believable. And of course, I remember I was watching the interview on the DVD where Ronald Shusett, who actually co-wrote Alien, actually talks about how Arnold Schwarzenegger would come up to me and goes, I can't say that line. People won't believe me saying that. Change it to this. And he said, I know how to write for me. And he said, at the time, I thought he was crazy. But then I realized when I saw it with an audience, they cheered that line and he knew what he was talking about.
One of the problems, though, was you had kind of a nice ending. You had kind of a happy ending. And Philip K. Dick books don't have happy endings. They have two endings. They have a very down or depressing ending, or they have a confusing ending where they explain something to you, the author explains something to you, and it's even twice as confusing as what you thought of before. There's many, many books, many stories like that.
All of his endings are kind of like Twilight Zone ending. It's like,
Twilight Zone, or they're very depressing.
They're cynical.
Very cynical.
Sometimes they're satirical in nature, and sometimes they're depressing.
Well, the thing about Total Recall is it ends, they didn't film the original ending. The original ending is that, you've probably already seen it, but he actually wakes up in the machine and everything was a dream. Mm-hmm. And that his life was,
That's more Philip K. Dick than what they did.
I would agree.
Philip K. Dick and happy endings are not synonymous. I'm sorry, folks. It's definitely like Blade Runner, expands above and beyond the little short story.
And I want to say the final thing, a great score, great villains, and Arnold Schwarzenegger gives probably one of his best performances. I know people say, well, he doesn't act. He's actually very good in the movie because he does sell that he doesn't believe who he is, and I thought he did a good job of that.
Yeah.
Very entertaining film.
Definitely one of my favorites.
Okay.
All right, well, that'll go on to our next film, and this is a film that I really liked. I saw it in the theater. Unfortunately, when I saw it, it was very confusing and didn't get the biggest release. But it's gone on to achieve a little bit of cult rep, and that film is Screamers, which is originally, again, written by Dan O'Bannon.
My favorite Philip K. Dick adaptation.
You would say that's your favorite?
Oh, yeah, really? Over Blade Runner. Yeah, it's my favorite one.
Interesting.
I love the story, and I love Peter Weller. I adore the story. I love the idea of the corporation versus the people. It's a very political film. You never think of it right away, but you get the little prologue at the beginning, the storyline, and it's a very political film.
You have to rewatch it.
Versus the working man.
You have to rewatch the opening credits because kind of like an opening text scroll, kind of like Star Wars, where it sets up the entire film, and if you miss it, you're kind of in deep shit. So rewind it a couple times.
That's an interesting point, just to say very quickly. That's what made Philip K. Dick unique for his time.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's done a lot. There were a lot of sci-fi writers doing dystopian futures where it was like this fascistic government. It's always like anti-government. What K. Dick was about was anti-corporation.
Just like me.
Which is a little different. And he was one of the first guys to do that. How our reliance on all sorts of different things like products, things like that. Corporations take advantage of that. They're the real power behind everything. And so his stuff was tinged with a bit of satire as well.
Anti-corporate and anti-war. This is before the Terminator. This is where James Cameron got the Terminator idea from.
Screamers came out after Terminator.
No. But the head, it's called Second Variety is the story that the Screamers is based on. And James Cameron's went on record by saying that Second Variety was one of the influences of Terminator. But no, it's the idea that the corporation, when the workers go on strike, the corporation, instead of firing them, they attack them. They attack the workers, and the workers in turn develop the Screamers, and the technology was so cutting edge that the Screamers developed AI, artificial intelligence, and they started building themselves. So the corporation and the workers, the union, had to join and form an alliance and go against the Screamers on this planet. And even though Peter Weller is a wonderful Philip K. Dick hero in this, because he's tired. He doesn't want to do this. He'd like to be home with his wife and kid or whatever. Reminds me a lot of Sean Connery's Marshall in Outland.
That's another underrated sci-fi classic.
You know, once again, you're on a moon. Mining, whatever profitable thing. Once again, it's an evil corporation.
And you're all alone with no family, nobody. You're just at an outpost, and it's like kind of like it's actually the same type of setup as an Outland. You're absolutely right.
Yeah.
And thanks for explaining that to me, by the way. I was very confused about that, because the movie, it's not as quite clear as the way you made it is clear, you know.
I've seen it several times, and you kind of pick up on it, but it's a lot deeper film than you can give it credit for when you watch it. And for having a small budget, they did really well. It only had like a week or two long release.
Yeah, I saw it in the theater, and I really liked the way it looked. I liked the action. I was just confused as hell, but I wasn't bored. You might want to give it a couple of looks. It's on DVD, so you can definitely get it.
It's a good little film.
All right, well, let's go on to the film, but believe it or not, I hate to say this, and I cannot believe I'm actually saying this, is that it's probably the most highly acclaimed Philip K. Dick story next to Blade Runner, but I honestly think it's an absolute piece of shit. And I'm not afraid to say that. I will look you into the camera and I'll say that, and if you don't like it, then I'm sorry. That film is Steven Spielberg's adaptation of Minority Report, which actually, I guess you say, takes a lot of the Total Recall themes. Stars Tom Cruise, and I go ahead, Mike. I can't describe. I hate this fucking film.
I don't know if it takes the Total Recall thing.
Some elements of Total Recall, some total elements of other stories. I mean, what's the story? What's the actual story that it's based on? Do you know?
It's based on Total Recall, isn't it? Isn't
that? No, that's Paycheck. Paycheck is another Philip K. Dick.
Oh, not Total Recall. I mean, Minority Report is the name of the short.
Yeah. Minority Report is the name of the story.
We'll just say it takes a lot of the classic themes.
And it was originally supposed to be filmed by Terry Gilliam. And
that I would have gone to.
We would have gotten a more true sense, because Terry Gilliam has went on record by saying that he loves Philip K. Dick and he would adapt a story very true.
Like 12 Monkeys is very Philip K. Dick.
Yeah. You know, has the same writer as Blade Runner, which is David Peoples, who wrote, you know.
And once again, you got that the cyclical problem that you see in like some Philip K. Dick stories, that you get caught in like this, you know, you don't get a happy ending.
Talk about the most depressing version of the future, but not to go on to about, 12 Monkeys, but let's not go on that one. But we got to review that one day, Terry Gilliam films. Mm-hmm. But I will go on record. The thing that I hate is that, why does that movie have to take place in the future? It does not have to take place in the future. It's drearily filmed. The ending.
Oh, the critics love that part.
Oh,
well, Eric, tell us about Minority Report.
Let me just quickly give you my. I hate the movie too, but the problem had it has to be in the future, because the whole premise is about that. That's where the film fucks up. Okay. The movie should have ended at a certain point in this film.
I agree.
This is Spielberg's problem with films of that time. During this period of time that he was making movies, there's a point where his film should end, where the films will be fine, but then he has to go on and ruin the film by adding another half an hour, 45 minutes of stuff, trying to justify that this person is a hero and he will win out and blah blah blah. The whole idea behind Minority Report is that you can't stop time. What you see in the future is unstoppable. It happens, and even though the whole idea is that, okay, this guy is a hero, there's no way he could have killed this person, he must have been set up. No. The twist at the end is he did kill this person. He can't stop it.
Yeah.
In fact, at the very end, he reaches the point where he has to kill that person that he's been accused of killing. But Spielberg ruins it by putting out this whole tag on, like, 45 minutes where they explained the whole thing. And
Hallelujah.
That's what killed the film.
Can you please
quote it? Philip K. Dick movies, stories cannot have happy endings.
Yeah, the magnet
but there's
cars.
Like laziness in there. There's that scene where like he's getting his eyes operated on.
That's terrible.
You have the character that's played by what's his
Peter
name?
Stormare.
Peter Stormare, a guy that he fucked over in the past. Why would Peter Stormare
help him?
Yeah, at first it's a real sinister premise, like this guy has him in his clutches.
This is interesting, but the more you think about it, it doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't. He's like, here's the string if you want to get something to eat, and here's the string for the bathroom. And it's like, oh, all of a sudden hijinks. It's filled with inappropriate humor. That's a problem I have with Saving Private Ryan. It's one of the, I'm sorry to take the Philip K. Dick show and turn it into the Steven Spielberg bitch session, but he fills his films full of inappropriate humor, just like watching the eyeballs fall down the stairs there as he's trying to chase the eyeballs down so he can get in.
Or the flame, the jetpack cooking the hamburgers. It's stupid stuff like that. The thing that got me, that it has the dumbest, I guess I don't know if you call it a plot hole or just the dumbest story turn I've ever seen in a movie today, is where the reason he gets his eyes transplanted is that because anywhere he walks, his retinas can be detected. Mm-hmm. And that's why he gets a transplant to a Japanese eyes, which is a ha ha ha, very funny. But the thing that's dumb is that he goes, can I have my old eyes? So he uses his old eyes to scan them to get back into his place of work. It's like, hello, you can be detected anywhere you go in the world, but if you use your old eyes to go into your job, they won't find you. Do you remember that scene?
And you brought that up on previous shows.
I hate that. I'm sorry. That just drives me crazy.
What about the, you have this wonderful scene of the searcher robots, the spider robots, mm-hmm. that are looking for him. And you have these people arguing, and then the robots go up and scan them, and then they resume argument. It's like, what is that? Like the updated futuristic version of the Honeymooners?
Well, I guess we can all say one thing, that that's definitely the worst Philip K. Dick adaptation, I would go on record as saying. Anyway, there's one more Philip K. Dick adaptation we're going to talk about, and this is a film which actually was in development a very long time. When it was announced, I was just scared shitless because I really do not like the director these days, and that's Richard Linklater, and he was going to film it in a style that I really was not too keen with, which is the rotoscoping technique, kind of developed by Ralph Bashy, very similar to that anyway, where they...
No, you're right. It was developed.
It was developed by, and it was actually, the film that he used it in previously, and I will go on record, is the most pretentious and worst piece of shit I've ever seen, which is Waking Life. So I had very high reservations about seeing it. But I saw it, and it wasn't as bad as I expected it would be, but it still had some problems. And that film is A Scanner Darkly. And Mike, I'm going to have you take this one, because I know you
I'll were, tell you, you it was a lot. It was, at first when I read about it, I thought, this is... I don't know. I didn't know what to think of it. I wasn't sure if rotoscoping would work. I thought it worked. I wasn't sure Keanu. I actually was positive that Keanu Reeves would have a wonderful chance at ruining this film, like he did ruin Constantine. But Constantine had a lot of other problems. But anyway, that's not Philip K. Dick. He was good. He was good as this hero. And Woody Harrelson was good. Then again, Robert Downey Jr. is never bad in anything. I will say on the CineFiles, he's not bad in anything, although I didn't see that Tim Allen Shaggy D.A. or the Shaggy Dog or whatever. But anyway, it was very, very true to the story. Very true to the story. And I give major kudos to Richard Linklater about a cop that is investigating drug dealing in a very, very near future. I think in the credits or in the prologue, they say 10 years from now. They don't give a date. They just say 10 years from now. I could be wrong about that. And it seems like it's in modern times. It's not, you know, futuristic. The only thing that's futuristic is the skein suit or whatever he wears, the hologram suit.
Which is a device that's kept to keep the people's identity a secret when they're going in because they're under deep cover.
What happens is he's on a drug, he's addicted to a drug, and then his personality splits in two. And one side of his brain is the drug dealer or the drug addict.
The identity he assumes.
And then the other half of his brain is the cop investigating himself. And it's a wonderful head trip. It's the future and its drugs, and that is Philip K. Dick in its soul. And I give Linklater
much
kudos
here,
to that.
So, Eric,
it is the most faithful adaptation of Philip K.
I'll give you
novel.
That.
And
it
I
like
the movie a lot. I actually, it's one of those films where it took me, I saw it initially, and I liked it, but it took me a while to think about it before I decided to like it better than I initially liked it. I think it warrants a second viewing. My initial reaction was, with the exception of the bodysuit stuff, I couldn't figure out why it needed to be animated.
Oh, but when Rory Cochrane has his mental breakdown.
Well, yeah, but the more I thought about it, you know, the more I liked it because of that, it occurred to me that there's things that really enhance it. Like, I love that whole thing at the end where Keanu Reeves is in the field looking, like, at all those flowers. And that is just stunning, mm-hmm. you know, in that rotoscoped animation.
Mm-hmm. My problem is with the rotoscoping technique, actually, is because the thing is that you know the actors that they're playing, and it's just that you can't, for me, it was very hard to separate the people from the animation. If they were, like, animated as different characters, you know what I'm saying?
Well, you see, I like the fact that you could identify with them. That made it easier to
identify. I didn't want them to be Disney characters.
I mean, I wish they would have filmed it as, like, a real live action film.
I thought it actually made it more interesting.
Maybe make the scenes, like the hallucination and the other scenes, maybe put in some inserts of the
rotoscope. But you got to watch it again, Edwin, because I think that in the Dick story, if you read the story, maybe you should read the book and then watch the movie again, because the whole book is based on the head trip from this guy's perspective. And I think adding the rotoscoping makes it the head trip that it was supposed to be in
the
story.
But you could have done that with CGI or just regular animation over
live
action.
I don't know. CGI is so overused these days.
Well, you could have done animation with actual live
action.
No, I
think it was a very unique way of interpreting the story. And I had the initial reaction you had. And my reaction was, I'm not sure it needed to be animated, though. Why do they need to do that? But then the more I thought about it, it occurred to me that scenes that resonated for me only worked because they were animated. And I love the idea that you recognize as Woody Harrelson, cool. You recognize as Winona Ryder, and you recognize as Keanu Reeves, because you know that you're watching them as performers, but then something just not quite right visually is going on too. It's like Mike says, it's like a head trip.
I think you're right. It is probably the most faithful adaptation of a Philip K. Dick story. There is some confusing parts that you might have to, like, rewind if you have your player, identity switching.
But also,
I got a little confused with
really
that.
The book is very confusing.
Oh, I mean, it's obvious because, I mean,
but
he's
intentionally
in
this, so. But, it's supposed to be confusing.
But I thought it's a very interesting film, nevertheless. I mean, I do like a lot of the stuff in it, especially the story. The story is really good. I'll give credit where that's due. I mean, I really like it. And the best thing of all, and as Mike will say, it does not have a happy ending. It has a very depressing ending. And another thing, check out the documentary on the DVD. It has some very rare footage of interviews with Philip K. Dick, which are even more fascinating than the film themselves. Anyway, we got to wrap this up, but this was a good show. I hope you enjoyed it. We can all agree, though, probably the best film of the bunch is Blade Runner. I mean, I know, Mike, you love screamers, but hey, the only one that's really you got to avoid is Minority Report.
His books and also his movies are big into what you see is not always what you get.
It's like he was probably schizophrenic. He believed that he had suddenly saw the light and that we were actually all descended from, you know, some other, whether it's aliens or something like that. And
his writings just on his personal philosophies are very, very way out in left field.
Not your traditional sci-fi kind of writer.
I've read a little bit about
philosophy guy.
He sounds like he's a really fascinating guy, and it's obvious he was a radical, you know, like a, I could say like a 60s type, Jerry Rubin type. I'm not saying he was a political, like, you know, out there, but he believed in a certain concept.
But he wasn't very popular while he was. I mean, he didn't actually reach his success until weirdly posthumously. I mean, like, up until
Yeah, he reached success maybe in the last 2 years of his life.
Yeah.
Because he was actually on the set of Blade Runner. He wasn't really
happy. He died
really
just after Blade Runner.
Yeah, he wasn't happy with the making of Blade Runner for whatever reason. But, no, he was poor most of his life. He ate dog food because he couldn't afford real food. He could afford amphetamines, though, and that's what helped him write so much, as he got so high on amphetamines.
That's the most fascinating thing to me about Philip K. Dick, because you had an excellent overview there, is where everyone thinks the future ever automatically is better. You know, technology is great. This is going to be great. But the thing is that you see that 1984 aspect in his... Hi, I'm Edwin Samuelson, and welcome to the CineFiles. Mike, I'm going to tell you what. I know you're a huge science fiction guy, and you know a lot about Philip K. Dick, so why don't you give us a little overview of the guy.
A huge Philip K. Dick fan. I adore his stuff. What is wonderful about Philip K. Dick's work is it is very gray. He is big on the dystopia. He shows that human beings are not going to live in this, like, Star Trek world where everything is great and nice, and he loves delving into alternative history. He loves delving into other dimensions.
His work, where the you know, someone is watching, someone is trying to take advantage of you. Not everyone is who they seem to be.
He almost runs a parallel by saying the more technology man has available, the more a man de-evolves.
Well, let's get into his filmmaking, because I mean that's important here. Let's talk about the first film, and actually, I mean, if any, I mean, if this is going to be the first work adapted from your stuff, you're damn lucky. And that is Blade Runner.
Set the tempo.
Which was filmed by Ridley Scott. It was his follow-up to Alien.
Yeah, it's based on Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, which is a novella.
A novella, and it was expanded.
Short novel.
It was expanded by David Peoples, who actually went on